I'll probably walk in and out of frame. That's a good lesson if you got a YouTube channel. Don't walk in and out of frame like I do. I like to walk around, be a little animated when I talk. One of the sergeants when I was in the Army gave us a bit of lecture on how to lecture, and he was walking around, he was animated, he was gesturing, changing his tone of voice a little bit. And then I don't know what he did. I think he just stood still and talked in monotone. But he did that for about 30 seconds, and everyone in the room literally fell asleep, which is a bad thing in the Army, so he screamed at us all, but he was trying to put us to sleep. So if you're talking in your YouTube channel, make sure you're acting in a way that's going to engage your audience. If you sound bored, they'll probably be bored. I have to remind myself that all the time.
What was your trade?
Trade? I was a medic.
Medic?
Yeah. Way back in the day. Was a good lesson to remember. The other one I have to remember as public speaker is talk to the back of the room. So you guys in the back can't hear me ever go like this or throw that spear at me or something like that. And I'll remember that you guys are part of the audience as well. I tend to, sometimes it's really easy to just talk to the front of the room, and sometimes when I get thinking, it's really easy to look down and think to myself. But you're engaging with your audience, whether you're live or whether you're on video. So remember that you want to make it good and interesting for them. So I brought some notes along because I wanted to cover a lot of points fairly quickly. First point I wanted to make, I've got my camera. If you want to be a videographer, not necessarily a YouTuber, or, you know, whatever channel you're using, take your camera everywhere you go. Show of hands, who's got a camera with them? Yeah, most of the room. But have it everywhere you go. You never know when something's going to happen. Something interesting might come up that you think, oh, this would be something I want to share. The other thing I always like to ask before a panel, is this anybody's first con? No, we're all veterans. Ooh. Here. Oh, one, yeah. Just Tsukino con welcome. My first con was at UVic as well, in 1980, Fair Isle, and then Imagine Con, we're one of your science fiction and fantasy cons. So the tradition of conventions at UVic goes back a long way. Alternate reality days in the 80s, and Tsukino con. Which number is this one? Anyway, whatever, it's been going on forever, and it seems to be getting more and more people every year, so that's great. I posted a couple videos of walkthroughs last year of the convention. It's just stunning how many costumes there are here. I go to science fiction cons more often than anime cons, and there's way more costumes at the anime cons. So, to introduce myself, I'm Karl Johanson. I edit Neo-opsis Science Fiction magazine. My primary job, and I sell a little bit of fiction on the side. And some of what I do on my YouTube channel is related to science fiction, but I do all kinds of everything. The advice I saw on just about everything I looked up on how to run a successful video channel was have your focus, whatever it is you're into. Mm-hmm. If you're into anime costuming, have an anime costuming channel. And I violated that principle completely. I have videos of my dog. I've got videos of the bomber I'll show later up at Tofino. I've got science fiction videos. I've got convention panel videos. Anything I find interesting. My top video is one of a slug. If you want to follow the standard advice, focus, focus, focus. If you want to do like I do, anything you find interesting, put it up on your channel and get more stuff on your channel for that. As of this morning, what did I have? 457,000 views. That's over a 10-year period on YouTube. So I'm not one of the giant players. If you want advice from the giants, I find often their advice isn't much more than do something really interesting, and it's not that helpful. Some people just catch an increasing returns wave, and they get really popular. Some people will thrive on controversy. And that's one way to popularity. It's not my thing. I'm not going to look up every controversial topic and try and get arguments going on in my channel. But if you want lots of views, controversy is the way to do it. Whatever's cutting edge, whatever's right in the news today, that's one way to get your channel lots of views. If you're a mistake I make, I do a lot of videos about classic Star Trek, so I'm 50 years behind the times. If I was doing stuff on the current Star Trek Discovery, I'd probably be getting more views. But it's what interests me. It's one of the things I'm passionate about, so if I do it, that passion tends to show when I'm talking about it. If I talk about whatever's current in the news that I'm not that interested in it, just to draw views, I think the viewers are going to notice I'm not actually that interested. But that's my advice. Cutting edge is probably better. If your favorite anime show is 50 years old, do your videos on that if that's what you want to do. If you want to do the cutting edge, that's the way to the numbers. So anybody here have video channel? Oh, that's good. Yeah, that's all right. I've got some business cards. Another thing to remember about having your YouTube channel or your video channel, it's perfectly okay to ask people to subscribe. My YouTube address is on the cards. If anybody wants to grab one at the end, please do so. If you subscribe, if you want to make a comment on one of my videos that mentions TsukinoCon, then I'll know it was one of you guys and I can subscribe back. I'd like to see this sort of work some of the people here are doing. That would be interesting. So yeah, remember that. It's okay to ask people to subscribe. I had a strange acronym I wrote down on here. SVSC. Doesn't really pronounce well. SVSC. If you want to help out a friend's channel or you want to get your friends to help out your channel, subscribe, vote up, share, and comment. That's where I got the SVSC from. I couldn't come up with a way to make a real word out of it. That really helps your channel out immensely. If more people are subscribed, it's not just that more people hear about your video because they're a subscriber. That helps your rankings. If you get lots of comments on your videos, that helps. If you get lots of vote ups, even if you get lots of vote downs, if you didn't like it, they all help. Yeah.
I'm just thinking, because I can make an acronym out of that. If you change vote to upvote, you can rearrange them to cuss. I'm not sure that's a great acronym.
Comments, yeah.
Comment, upvote, share, and subscribe.
Yeah. Yeah, comment, upvote, share, subscribe. Yeah, cubs. Cubs. Okay, everybody remember cubs. We'll remember that. So next year, everybody will have lots more viewers. You can also tell people when they subscribe. In YouTube's case, there's a little bell icon next to the subscribe button. If they click that button after hitting subscribe, then that means they get email notification of your videos. It's not just, you know, when they go onto YouTube, but they'll get, you know, Karl posted a new video from TsukinoCon about such and such. If this looks okay, I'll probably post it. Make good videos. That's standard advice, too. Best you can do. Make sure your things are in focus. Make sure you've got good lighting. Make sure you're speaking clearly. That's the one I have trouble with. Sometimes I'm so busy thinking about what I'm going to say, I start thinking, which isn't any good for your audience at all. You want to be clear. If you're recording an audio track or you know, a commentary while you're in view and you mess up, that's okay. It happens. I'll do it here. I'll say a few times and I'll get confused and think about what I'm doing. That's all right. But just keep going, or just do it again. I've started one video 11 times in a row. It's just, no, I worded it wrong, start again. And the first few times I messed up while recording, I could hear my teachers going, Karl, you're doing it wrong! And it flustered me. And it's like, no, there's nobody watching while you're recording. You just keep doing it, cut off the parts you don't want. That's another important part. Edit. And I'll say it again, edit. If there's stuff in your video that's not really germane to the video, like you see it quite often, there's a car crash video where the truck hits the other thing. And then you've got 4 minutes of the car driving down the I-5, and then near the end it gets to the point, well, edit it. Now sometimes I think that's because somebody's just videoed on their phone, they don't have a video editing program, they just stuck the whole video up quickly, I understand. But if you're running a channel, you probably want to get a video editor. Windows Movie Maker is quite good. Anybody use it? Yeah. Macs I'm not that familiar with, but I understand the Macintosh video editor is quite good. I use Adobe Premiere. It's extremely good. It lets you do extracting background colors. If you put a green screen behind you or something like that, or blue sky behind you will usually work as well. You can extract backgrounds. You can do a lot of video on video work. That's what I did this one. You can see I've got the video playing behind me. Animation drawing.
That's me.
Oh. I started off a little bit of graphics, but then what I wanted to show is that I've got myself talking and then I've got a second video playing beside me.
Japan's military target targets in Canada. This included intercontinental fire bombs.
Yeah, just, you can throw up videos, you can throw up pictures.
Submarine torpedo, your Canadian lumber scooter.
And a little bit of graphics I've done
and
there.
And a submarine shelling your Canadian.
It's one way to add a little bit to your video. If you're talking about something, you can show it as you're talking about it. And it's why I use the black background there, because I like to use, one of my favorite forms of animation is this kind of pseudo ray trace retro computer graphic style. And it's one of the few types of animation I personally think I'm good at, so I like to do that. So if I've got a back black, see, there, I messed up and it's okay. I screwed up a word and I just keep going. The black background shows off the ray trace graphics I'm doing quite well. Although on occasion I'll do somebody's hair fairly dark and it looks like they don't have a head. You have to watch that. But if I green screened, I could do the same sort of thing. But I don't have a big green screen. I've got a nice black curtain I can use. Have a room where there isn't that much background noise. If you can, if you're recording, you know, just a voiceover like this. That way you don't have, you know, occasionally you can hear cars in the background in there because the room I'm in isn't completely soundproof. But if you can do it, that's good. If you're outside filming a bunch of people walking past in their costumes, you're gonna have background noise, that's okay too. But if you're talking and the point of what you're doing is the audio track, try and keep the background noise as good as you can. And that can be a matter of which camera you use as well. A couple of the videos I have posted are of concert videos. I got my Prism t-shirt on under this. Prism's one of my favorite bands, and I recorded a few of their songs at a concert. And then I emailed them after the concert, said, here's the video. I know it's yours, I'll post it without monetizing it, with your permission only. If you don't want me to post it, you don't even have to give me a reason, right? It's your work. Just say no and I'll be quite happy, but they gave me permission to post them. So that's a good thing to remember if you're posting someone else's work like that. But I recorded a song with two different cameras at the same time. And one of them, the vocals were terrible. It sounded like they'd forgotten how to sing. On the other camera, it sounded amazing and it carbonated my bloodstream. It was so beautiful. So before you post somebody else's music, make sure it sounds good for their sake, because it might be your camera that's not picking up the audio track with all that, you know, bass noise and everything, hammering the camera at the same time. If you're posting a clip, say, you know, you go see a concert and you want to post a 20-second clip, hey, I'm out watching my favorite band play, I think that's more fair use than posting the whole song. But even then, try and make sure if you're going to post it, they sound good on the video. Same with a hockey game, a sports event, that sort of thing. If you're going to post a clip, that's one thing. If you're going to post the entire work, then you're not really in the fair use category. And in which case, definitely don't monetize it if it's someone else's, is my thought. On monetization, my YouTube channel's been monetized for a few years now. I think you needed 100 subscribers and a record of a fair number of videos posted regularly. YouTube's just changed their parameters, and the changes take effect in a couple of weeks. You'll need 1,000 subscribers and 4,000 hours worth of views in the previous year. And apparently they have their reasons for doing it. To me, it's like, well, we've been giving you monetizable content for years and you just decided we're not good enough anymore, is what it feels like to a lot of the YouTubers. Mm-hmm. But they have their monetary and their reasons for it. Some of it is sometimes somebody can set up a quick YouTube channel and just put up nasty content to comment on somebody else's video. It's all just trolling and nastiness, and they don't have the manpower to monitor every new video that comes up. And what they don't want is, like, if somebody's an advertiser, they don't want their advertising coming up on some Nancy promoting video. Understandable. So they decided we're only going to monetize past this level now. So if you, that's part of why I've got my subscriber cards out there with how to subscribe to the channel.
Did you say it has to be 1,000 subscribers and how many hours?
4,000 hours of views in the previous year.
4,000. How do they calculate 4,000 hours of views?
They keep track. If somebody watches my video and it's 10 minutes long and they watch 3 minutes of it, I get 3 minutes of credit.
That is for each and every person. Like every person who watches 3 minutes is put towards your 4,000 hours.
Yeah. And you can go on your analytics in YouTube and it'll show you, you know, you had this many views today, this many of this video. Average viewing time was whatever, 10 minutes for your videos. It shows you where a lot of them came from, where they know, what countries around the world, whether it's a man or a woman watching it. Apparently, most YouTubers are men at this point. There's other social medias that are weighted more on women. So I keep looking, wondering why so many of my videos are being watched mostly by men, and it's because that's who does most of the YouTube watching. But apparently, they're, as I understand, they're leveling off. I'm not sure about that, but that's what I'm told. Yeah, so it'll give you a report on your video. Part of why they're judging based on hours of view is if somebody's got a YouTube channel and they just want to say, look, I've got 10 million views, and they've got a bot running through Hide My Ass or some other program that just keeps clicking on their videos over and over and over to artificially boost their view count. That's fairly easy to do. But what's not fairly easy to do is boost hours and hours and hours of viewing time. It's still doable to an extent. But I don't think it's a good way to get your views anyway. It's you know, if it's just going to click and then watch 2 seconds of your video, it's going to show people are clicking on your videos and turning them off right away. So like they're not finding them interesting. As questions come up, just throw your hands up too.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
In that case, back to the subject of asking permission now. Recently, I released a video in which I used someone else's music, and on their channel, they under the song, they have the following statement. Royalty-free music, I am Mew, a musician who loves writing dark piano songs. They are free to use as long as credit is given. Now, I didn't actually end up asking permission, but I did take that statement and give credit both in the song description and at the end of the video.
Oh, yeah.
Is that acceptable?
That's acceptable.
Okay, okay.
And be fair to them, too. If you're going to post a video about how the Nazis were awesome and you realize, gee, they really don't want their music associated with this, don't do it. Like, nobody in here is going to do that. But that's an extreme example. If
fuck Nazis.
If you can tell the whole point of the music is the opposite of what the point of your video is, maybe you want to find a different one. But otherwise, yeah, I've done that. YouTube has a number of videos available on that licensing of just attribute. And what you did, I think, is good too. You didn't just put it in the description. You put a mention in the video itself. Because not everybody's going to read it.
A script mention, specific, like I had a credits card at the end.
Yeah, and that's a wonderful idea. It's a good way to do it. There is a lot of very interesting music. Like if you've just got a slideshow of you know, your favorite flowers, a little bit of music punches it up a bit. The other way I get music, there's a lot of digital synthesizers online, drum synthesizers and music synthesizers, and I've made some very simple, I'm not that much of a musician, but I've made a bit of simple music, and I think it can punch your video up if it's otherwise silent.
Can you recommend one of those? Or?
I should have wrote some of them down, but I just search online synthesizer and you can find them. Some of them have some of the older Moog and ARC synthesizer sounds from the 70s that are really the sound from my mind. Again, I'm not being cutting edge by doing that. But yeah, you can do it. If you've got anything else other than music that's not your content, being fair about it, I've done, like, if I do a classic Trek review of one of the episodes, say, I'll mention who the writer was, that sort of thing. And again, I'm using clips, so hopefully fair use.
Is fair use kind of thrown out? It's like the rules of fair use kind of like thrown out of the window or blurred once monetization becomes a very prevalent factor into it. Like I know a couple of times, like I know that fair use is supposed to be good for parody or like educational purposes. But if you have a monetized video, I think I've seen this a couple of times where like they still get some strikes over it. Mm-hmm. Does the monetization change anything? Like does it like supersede, is there like rules that supersede fair use after you monetize the video?
Yeah, often what happens is they just say, you know, that's really not your music, we're not going to let you monetize that video. We'll leave it on, but we're not going to let you get any revenue from ads on it.
Yeah.
That can be a mistake too. My wife, one of her videos, she used some YouTube common license sound on it, and somebody else put a claim in saying that's my music. And so it's not monetized now. The video's still there. Well, it wasn't their music. It had a little sound click of water that sounded similar to the water in the YouTube one.
That happens a lot.
Yeah, it happens. The problem is any video with less than 1,000 views is really hard for YouTube to afford to have somebody check. So it's been a month since she put in a claim saying, that's not their music, here's where I got it from, your licensing said I was allowed to use it. But because it's under 1,000 views, you're not looking at a huge amount of revenue lost. But it is just kind of irksome that, you know, why are you claiming I stole your music when I didn't?
Yeah, but yeah, no, like monetization can kind of like supersede fair use in that sense because they don't want you to make money off of their content.
Yeah, you know, that can be fair. If it's review and you're not showing the entire movie and commenting over it, that's usually fair use if you're using some clips of it.
Patreon, however, like if you have a Patreon page and you're making money during off of that, does that become effective? Can they strike you for having a Patreon?
That I'm not sure of. What are you referring to? Like some people can get a Patreon account and say, every video I do or every video you do, I'm going to put 10 cents or a dollar or whatever in because I really like your video channel and want to support it.
Yeah, the way the Patreon works is like, I'm sure you've heard of Patreon, is that you announce, at the end of the video, you'll say that you have a Patreon page. If you want to support me, put in, you can make a pledge on the Patreon, like $1 a month or more, depending on whether you choose. And if they know that they have a Patreon, which they are getting income from, does that allow them to put a strike against the video just because they have the Patreon and they're using it?
I don't think Patreon would be a negative to YouTube or any other video channels. That's my understanding.
All
right. Plus, when you've got some of the really good YouTubers who have Patreon, they may do some short brief, hey, you know, here's a funny thing that happened to me. It's not one of their standard videos, and they say, I haven't put this on the Patreon list. Because, you know, it's not one that they put the standard effort they put into their videos. It's just a little chatty. You know, hey, I went to KinoCon, there's a whole bunch of cool costumes, you know. Why would you, you know, then take a dollar for everybody who's donating for something simple like that? But some other Patreon people, they seem to just go out of their way to crank out a whole bunch of videos just to get more money in it. I don't think that's a fair way to do it.
Can you, once you've monetized your channel, which actually I have no intention of doing, but I have a friend, he might, once you've monetized your channel, can you intentionally demonetize one of your own videos?
Oh yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, when you're uploading it, and after you've uploaded it, you can go in and change it at any time. I've got a couple notices, as in retrospect, okay, yeah, like, that's fair. Like I videoed some rec league hockey, I play rec league hockey. But I don't have a written permission from everybody on the team necessarily to do it. It was a public event, so it's okay to show it, but they said this is their standard, don't monetize that. So anything like that, I haven't since. Here, it's mostly me. If it was, it's arguable, the guy who asked a question in the audience is part of the video, should he be allowed, did he get his permission to use the video? Maybe you shouldn't monetize it, but I said at the beginning I was videoing it, so anybody objects to their questions being included, just tell me. I can edit them out. I don't think anybody would, but that's a way around that issue of it's a public event. Is it okay to post it in that way? One thing is, you never know what's going to be popular. I put huge amounts of work into some of my videos, and I thought this is going to be my big video, and it's not necessarily doesn't necessarily get that many views. And it's not always your fault. You're competing against billions of hours of video. This is my most popular video. I almost didn't publish it because I thought, it's not really that good. But I saw a slug when we were up at Cox Bay Tofino. Anybody go up there ever? Awesome place, yeah.
Sad that I don't get much chance being from the mainland.
Yeah. Anyway, I saw a little slug on the ground and I thought, you know, they move so slow. And I realized, with the camera, you can change time. It's taken a second.
Oh.
Yeah. See if it'll do it. Oh, no, I added the wrong one. This is my Lego video. I'll talk about my Lego video in the meantime. This was filmed in Super 8 film. Way back in the day. Is it playing? Nope.
You just locked the panel.
We got a tech here. Anyway, I'll talk while he's working on stuff. When I started doing model animation, it was back in the film era, so you would buy 3 minutes of Super 8 film or 8mm before Super 8. And I was doing 24 frames a second film, So if I did 3 minutes of video at 24 frames a second, that was a lot of moving the little Lego pieces or the clay or whatever I was moving around. A lot of work. And you didn't know until you were done if everything was okay. You didn't know if your lighting was out. You didn't know if you'd accidentally left something in screen or if your framing wasn't set up well because you didn't have a digital screen to look at what the final product screen was. And then you get it back. So I spent 50 hours doing one of the video that the lighting is absolutely terrible on. It's really annoying. We've got digital cameras now, so everybody feel really lucky about the digital cameras. You can see your images as you're taking them. Yeah. You can tell if the lighting's okay. You can tell if things are in frame. And yeah, what I did here, I was just having some fun moving some Lego around. This was long before the digital Lego movie came out. And it shows a interesting thing. I've got a little truck moved up. This is supposed to be the generator powering the Lego grid. So I was trying to make a little bit of a story as you're watching it, and that's powering the little crane. And it shows something too about sometimes your mistakes are where your good work comes from. Because you can see the little lights moving on the power plant there. Every time I move them for every frame, and I stopped, I forgot to move them for a bunch of frames in a row. You can see it here, the lights just stop. So I thought, oh, what do? So I had the truck back up and ram the power plant to get it started again. And I think it makes the scene way better. It's like it's suddenly more alive. You can also see I'm adjusting my angle of view when I'm down in here. It's not just in the camera in one place and do the whole video. Changing your perspective, I think, helps a video like that. You can see I zoom in on the crane a little bit. Also, an interesting thing, when I'm moving the crane, it looks very mechanical. And when my wife came and helped me do some of the animation, she moved the crane in a totally different way. It looked like a snake and that it was alive. So yeah, so that'll help you get the numbers. The other thing is there's often forums. If I've got one of my reviews about classic Star Trek, I'll go to a classic Star Trek forum and post it there. I'm not going to post it on every forum known, because that's just going to piss people off. If I go into a forum about Honda motorcycles and post my Star Trek video, it's just annoying. But there are usually lots of channels, and because I've got such a wide range of videos, there's French Bulldog forums. I've got a French Bulldog that's featured in a lot of my videos, so I'll post it there, fair use. But I also will tend to participate in the forum. If you're just the guy who shows up, goes, watch my crap, and leaves, and doesn't add comments to anybody else's forums, and isn't really part of the community, you're not as likely to get extra views out of it. You might get a few, but if you're like, hey, it's that guy who keeps coming in, and he's got all the cool stories about his French Bulldog, I will show him. Got it. Just as an example of how wide a variety of stuff I have, this has nothing to do with Star Trek, but we've got a cute little French Bulldog Beagle combo. Let's see if that's going to actually play. And I think he's so cute it should have had 500,000 views, but you know, it's in a couple of hundred views. That's him and his little brother at the pet store when we got him. Isaac. But again, it's not that this isn't an exceptionally cute dog, and a pretty decent dog video is, I'm competing against tens of millions or possibly billions of cute animal videos. So that's, you know, if there he is climbing up the laundry, that's my favorite part. I wanted to stop him, but he was too damn cute. He's like, quick, get the camera, right? Pull the camera out of your pocket. There he is in my hockey pads. So yeah, to me, this is one of my videos that I thought, oh, this has just got to be grabbing me tens of thousands of views, and it didn't. And it's not that there's anything wrong with the video, so it's here. It's a matter of what the market and what happens to be popular that day and where I posted it. Here he is up at point, no point. There is audio on it too, but it's not really relevant. And there he is with a GoPro camera on his back. You can see him running away. And then I think I've got the forward view and with it. Yeah. So I thought that was kind of a cool thing to do, was just strap this GoPro on his back. So I want to do a bit more of that because I think it's funny. The problem is if you're going to do a GoPro video with the video on the dog's back, don't make it very long because the camera's going to be doing this and shaking. And after a couple of minutes of that, your audience is going to get dizzy and nauseous, or some of them will anyway, and they won't want to watch it. I noticed the same thing. I filmed an entire hockey game with a GoPro camera on my helmet, and it looked amazing. The view, it's like I was saying, the NHL's got to put GoPros on all their hockey players so that you can zoom in on whatever. But you don't want to watch an hour of hockey through a GoPro because, you know, you're skating like this and that's what the camera's doing the whole time. There's no still shot rig on my head. Oh, there he is pulling me along the ice on Panama Flats. But as I said, absolutely nothing wrong with the video. He's a really cool looking dog. It's fairly well edited. It looks good, high resolution. My lighting's good in almost every scene. And it didn't take off. But it did give me a bunch of views, and I'm happy with what it got. It's just, it's just my point is sometimes you never know which ones are going to be big. I think this one's way better video than the slug, and the slug's the one that got me the numbers. Yeah, I'm just making sure I get to all my points. One suggestion they said for helping out your numbers, your views, is to do crossover work with another video YouTuber. There's two different people here who do videos on costumes at anime cons. Do some work together. You can both post it, or you can appear as a guest on the other person's channel and vice versa, and you can advertise each other's channels, vice versa. And I haven't done that myself. It does seem like a good idea, but it seems like something that is going to be better. If you've got a small user and a big user, it's going to be really good for the small user, but it actually helps the big user as well if they do that sort of thing. It gets them a wider market. So that's something to consider. When I mentioned looking at the stats on your videos, it's fascinating to see. It's not just you've thrown your video out into the wilderness and you don't know how many people are watching it or who's watching it. You can see, how many did I get today? Oh, and I've got a trend. This video is doing this. This video is doing that. You can look up where the views are coming from. And if it's a direct YouTube search, it'll actually tell you the keywords people search on to find it. You know, some high-speed slug is something people searched, and that's how they found it. But if you've got... you can add keywords to your video. That's something I don't think I mentioned earlier. In this case, I would say... pets, dogs, dog owners, French bulldog, Frenchie, beagle, dog hybrids, funny dog videos, humorous dog videos. And if I notice a number of people got there because they searched hilarious dog videos, and I'm getting huge numbers of searches on that, I'll probably add hilarious dog videos to my keywords. And be fair, oh yeah.
I'm just curious whether you know whether that about that kids movie about the racing snail or racing slug, and whether that any of your traffic might have come from.
Oh, possibly. Yeah. And when did that come out?
Hashtag that. Around 5 years ago or so.
5 years. Yeah, so before mine then. Yeah, that might have driven some of it. Yeah.
It
mine
might
was
be
about 3 years ago.
Yeah.
Sometimes you get something similar driving it. But of course, be fair, like if I added Justin Bieber or some other popular songwriter's name, that might draw me a bit of traffic to the keywords, but it's really not very nice because my videos got nothing to do with it. And no comment on how good or bad he is as a musician. But any words you can think of that are fair, you know, I don't put hundreds and hundreds of keywords in, but if, you know, I've got dozens in some cases that all seem fair. If I've got a, you know, where I'm skating on Panama Flats there with a dog pulling me, I've got Panama Flats, Vancouver Island, Victoria, BC, Canada, skating, outdoors, sports, winter sports, ice hockey, ponds, Canada parks, anything that seemed relevant that somebody's not going to be pissed off and why am I going to this video? This is not the sort of thing I was searching for. You know, and I try and think myself that, like if I searched those keywords and I got one of my videos, would I be happy or pissed off? And then I try and be fair. And plus, if you pump your video full of currently popular keywords, YouTube will probably figure it out. Especially if you're big. The small guys might get away with it for a little while, but it's just an annoying thing, so I recommend not doing it. One of the things I talk about when I'm mentioning video channels is why do it? And it was a similar thing. It came up, it was one of the fanzines, Fact Sheet 5, I used to write in back before the internet, when chat rooms were called fanzines, and it took months for you to get any feedback through the mail. And they had a column that was called Why Write? And lots of people had different explanations on why they're writing. And everybody who writes has a different reason. Everybody who does videos and posts them has a different reason. Some of it is you want a bit of fame, but some of it might be you've got a message you want to get out. And that to me is one of the more important ones. Do I have something interesting I want to say? Now, a lot of my videos, the slug one, there's no message there other than that this looked really cool. But if I'm talking about something, if I'm reviewing something, I want to try and explain some insight into why I think that's interesting or why I think this is good or bad or right or wrong. David Gerald, the writer who wrote the Tribbles episode for Classic Trek, I'm probably paraphrasing him, but when he talked about writing, he said, write because you think you can make a difference. And I thought, that's a fair one. If you think you can make the world a slightly better place because you said the right thing, that's fair. But to me, that doesn't have to be your only motivation, but it is a good one. I tend to try and think in those terms of, am I saying something that's a good message here, or a bad message, or something that might help make the world better or more interesting? I jokingly say subscribing to my YouTube channel will help prevent nuclear war. That's on the on my channel description. And it's a way of saying, well, yeah, there are better things to do than fight wars. And one of them is watch cool videos. If we have a nuclear war, the electromagnetic pulses are going to screw up the internet and we're not going to be able to watch these cool videos. So among the numerous reasons to not have a nuclear war, such as it would be really mean and nasty and lots of people would die and get hurt and infrastructure destruction, it wouldn't be very fun, you know, and that's part of, like, this humorous, stupid thing I have for why you should join my YouTube channel, to me, has a little message hidden in it that maybe the world's a better place if we're doing this. Plus, with something like YouTube, there's YouTubers all over the planet. You know, you can see what's going on in somebody's life, not in a news sense, but in a personal sense. And one of the things that's driving that, I think, is YouTube's recent requirement that you need 1,000 subscribers rather than 100 subscribers for monetization.
I heard it was 10,000.
Yeah. Well, it's 1,000 is what I read, because I read it today.
Okay.
But there are a lot of people who are trying to get subscribers, so they're trying to go to other subscribers and find out if they've got an interesting channel and say, you know, I found your channel interesting, would you like to subscribe to mine as well? And a lot of the cases, they're finding people all over the world that they wouldn't necessarily subscribe to. And I think that's kind of a cool thing. It's not just me going around and going, okay, here's all my hobby horse topics, I'm going to subscribe to them. Thanks. I've got these people who are doing things I hadn't thought of that were that interesting, but they're putting an interesting slant on it. A friend showed me one of the TED Talks, and it was about origami. And I have no interest in origami, but it was the coolest video on origami I'd ever seen. And sometimes that's one thing you can find. If somebody's got a good channel, you know, I can look at it and go, well, I'm not really interested in that particular topic, but they've got a reputation for doing good videos, they probably have it, can make it interesting for me and broaden my horizons a little bit. So apparently we're running down the clock. Does anybody have any other questions before we wrap it up? So again, like I said, if you want to grab one of my cards, it's got my channel on there, explains how to do it. You don't need a YouTube account to subscribe to somebody's YouTube channel. If you've got a Gmail account, you just log into your Gmail, then go to their YouTube channel, hit the subscribe button, hit the little bell beside it to get your notifications, and then your friend will be happy because their subscriber numbers go up. For me, like I said, I'm aiming to try and get remonetized with the new numbers, but if it was just about the numbers, or just about the monetization, it's not worth it. I make more money taking my cans and bottles to the recycle people than I do on YouTube at this point. Which is a good thing to do too, right? But it's fun because it makes it feel like your work's valued. But seeing the numbers and seeing the comments by people who say, I saw your video on X and I really enjoyed it, that's awful, it's all about that. So thanks for coming out, everybody. Enjoy the rest of the con.